Okay, could I invite members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible. The final item of business today is a member's business debate on motion 6302 in the name of Emma Harper on transforming Scotland's vacant and derelict sites. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. So I would invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call Emma Harper to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open this members' debate and I thank the members who have signed my motion allowing us to debate transforming Scotland's vacant and derelict sites. I thought this was a motion which could have achieved all-party, cross-party support because it's relevant to most communities in Scotland as a third of the population lives within 500 metres of a derelict site. So I am a wee bit hanging luggit not to have any Conservative support. But perhaps the... Actually, there's three Conservative members that maybe be speaking that could explain why in their contributions. I want to thank the Scottish Land Commission for all they do to facilitate the change to Scotland's vacant, abandoned and derelict sites and to bring about practical solutions for the public sector. Real examples are presented in the Scottish Land Commission's Places to Live, Places to Power, Places to Grow, Play, Connect, Learn, Renew, Work and Imagine paper. In particular, I thank the Scottish Land Commission Chair, Andrew Thin, and the Head of Policy, Shona Glenn, for meeting with me and for their continued engagement with my office. Presiding Officer, as I said at the start, the legacy of Scotland's industrial past means that almost a third of the Scottish population currently lives within 500 metres of a derelict site. In communities on the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, that figure increases to 55%. Fixing urban dereliction could play a major role in addressing health inequalities and improving wellbeing, but the benefits don't just stop there. Tackling urban dereliction could help us solve some of society's biggest challenges. The benefits of addressing derelict land are obvious, yet we're still seeing heels being dragged when it comes to bringing about the change that's needed. The Scottish Land Commission has intimated that, for far too long, the issue of repairing, renewing and renovating brownfield derelict sites has been dumped on the too difficult pile. We need to change the narrative. We need to recognise the massive opportunity that presents us. Understanding and assessing the impacts of blight on those living near the derelict land provides a powerful evidence base to help communities and decision makers act. In addition to the obvious impacts of derelict sites, like the visual disturbance and embarrassment communities feel by living next to them, there is also substantial evidence of the negative health implications of dereliction. In 2016, the findings from joint research by the Scottish Land Commission, Glasgow Centre for Population Health, Glasgow University and partners was brought together in a report which for the first time identified the major causes of Scotland's excess mortality. And it's quite interesting that this point that I'm coming to now follows on from the health inequality debate that we've just had. One of the factors in the report identified what an adverse physical environment caused by living in and around dereliction happens. The study found that living close to or next to these areas leads to poor mental health, feelings of being unsafe, anxiety and persistent low mood. We have many derelict sites, Presiding Officer, across Dumfries and Galloway in the Scottish Borders. The George Hotel in Stranraer, former rubber or interfloor factory in Dumfries, Central Hotel in Annan, the Mercury Hotel in Moffat, and the Enfield and Glenmark buildings in Hoyk. However, in my engagement to See Action, I have responses from site owners and local authorities. The local authority response is, we do not have the powers to deal with derelict sites. So I checked. This was confirmed by the Scottish Parliament's Information Centre that local authorities do have several options available to act on derelict sites. These are very... Of course I will.
Finlay Carson.
The council in Dumfries and Galloway has been run by the SNP and Labour for more than a few years now. Why are you letting down the people of Stranraer who've had to live next to the George Hotel for all these years?
Emma Harper.
I didn't think personally that I'm letting anybody down, actually, and I'm coming to the issues that we want to address. I think it's very clear there are actions that could be taken. So In the SPICE briefing that I received, there were options available, so there are various funding sources, and the Scottish Land Commission even have a handy table of funding on their website, including for public sector bodies. In summary, local authorities can issue a wasteland notice to a property owner, a lessee or an occupier, requiring them to take specific actions to improve the condition of their building or land. And if that responsible person refuses, the local authority can then carry out the work themselves and claim back the cost from the owner under the Town and Country Plan in Scotland Act 1997. I will be happy to give way if there's a lot of interest in this. Depends on the time, because I've got a lot to cover.
I can give you your time back, Ms Harper, okay. Certainly. Stephen Kerr.
My intervention is very brief. My colleague asked a question in relation to the example cited in the motion. So given what Emma Harper has just said, why has the council controlled by your party not done that in the case that was mentioned by my friend?
Please, through the chair, and Emma Harper.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks for that intervention. I'm not a councillor, so I'm laying out what I see as the research that I've done for the last year so that we can help inform and educate and have people understand that there are actions that can be taken. So I'd like to continue and proceed. Thank you. The local authorities can do things like issue a wasteland notice to the property owner, right? Said that. If the responsible person refuses, they can carry out the work themselves, and that is referring to the Town and Country Planning Act in 1997. And also, under the Building Scotland Act 2003, councils can issue a dangerous buildings notice. And the local authority or community can, under the Land Reform Act 2003, make a compulsory purchase for a building or land and take action on it. And on the owners, I've written to the owners of many derelict sites, and I have had one single response. That's kind of disappointing. The Land Commission have recommended that we improve how we identify owners of the vacant and derelict sites, such as through a public register, which I would support. And I also support the introduction of compulsory sale orders, as recommended by the Scottish Land Commission. So I would welcome an update from the Government on progress towards bringing forward legislation to enable CSOs. And I therefore ask the Minister how we can better enable local authorities, such as through the National Planning Framework number 4, to use current legislation to transform our vacant, abandoned and derelict sites. And I would ask the Minister, how can communication with the owners of derelict sites be improved? One of the other common misconceptions that I'd like to highlight in dealing with derelict buildings is historic listing. People perceive that no action can be taken on some derelict buildings due to the listed status, whether it's Grade B or Grade C, for example, for historic or cultural reasons. This is my experience with the former factory in Dumfries. It's a Grade B listed site with historical architectural significance. But however, local authorities, they do have the ability to seek removal of or change to a current listed status. In effect, they can delist a property. This process is governed by Historic Environment Scotland, and it's an option that can take 8 weeks if there is a strong case to back up the change to the listed status. So local authorities, developers and communities must be more aware of this option so that action on derelict sites occurs. Presiding Officer, I know this issue of derelict buildings and sites is really complex, and that more time would be needed for me to explain the work that I've done over the last year, and as well as some specific examples around contaminated land and work that I've done with SEPA to assist me as well. So I've been working with Heathall Community Council in Dumfries to petition D&G Council to act on the total eyesore that is the Interfloor factory site, and that is just the start. So in closing, Presiding Officer, transforming Scotland's vacant, abandoned and derelict land is a central issue to health, to wellbeing and to community empowerment, and it is vital that we pay attention to this issue, and I look forward to colleagues' contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Finlay Carson to be followed by Colin Smith for around 4 minutes. Mr Carson.
I thank Emma Harper for bringing this debate to the Chamber. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is nothing more depressing than walking or driving past empty properties in many of our towns and communities that have simply been left neglected and allowed to crumble away over months and years. The problem of tackling abandoned buildings and subsequently derelict land is not, of course, restricted to one region, and I do recognise it's happening right across the whole of Scotland. But as we've heard, a prime example of this is the George Hotel in Stranraer, a once proud-looking building in the heart of a thriving town. It was a popular meeting point for locals and visitors alike. But when business fell away and the hotel was closed, the building was allowed to... It was allowed to become an absolute eyesore and left to fall apart. After years of neglect and after much pressure, the SNP Labour-led Dumfries and Galloway Council finally bought the hotel in 2017, but have done nothing with it. And this is despite the local authority having, as we've heard from Emma Harper, a strategy and the ability to act on neglected policy. I'll be happy to give way.
Thank you. I really appreciate you taking an intervention. We agree that the George Hotel is a total eyesore, and I think it's fabulous that, you know, we're highlighting this in the debate in Chamber. But would you agree that action has finally started to be taken to address this building and have the community decide what they want to do with it?
Finlay Carson.
I very much like to agree, but it's far too slow. Absolutely far too slow, and the Council has failed in their responsibilities to bring it forward. You know, we've got a strategy with Dumfries and Galloway Council, which is often reviewed, but it often, and it has always, failed to deliver for our communities. An application has been submitted to see money being made available through the UK Government's Levelling Up scheme to provide millions of pounds of funding towards the redevelopment, and hopefully a decision will be forthcoming to give it a new lease of life. But sadly, this is an exception rather than the norm. Indeed, just last week, the windows of another abandoned building in Stranraer fell out, forcing the property to be boarded up, and it was lucky that nobody was injured. So clearly, it's fair to say that action is needed to ensure vacant and derelict sites are given a new lease of life quickly and, critically, with a greater pace of engagement with the local community involved. And while it's vital that property owners and community groups have the opportunity to consider options for the reuse or temporary reuse of vacant and derelict land, the need for consultation cannot be allowed as a way to kick action into the long grass. But what is hoped for in the likes? But what hope is there for the likes of Stranraer with a Labour and SNP administration in charge? There's £6 million of ring-fence money set aside when the ferries moved, but not one penny spent, not one penny, by this ineffective and dysfunctional administration. Despite Wigtonshire overwhelmingly rejecting them in the elections just this year, the electorate are disgusted that a grubby deal between the SNP and Labour has allowed them to continue in administration. All of that said, any strategy that looks at addressing the problem of empty buildings and land has to be welcomed, and indeed Dumfries and Galloway has just recently refreshed its approach. While the new strategy is not exactly groundbreaking in any shape or form, you cannot fault it for providing the local authority, if it acts quicker and responds with renewed energy and urgency, rather than sit back and allow buildings to fall into disrepair. On this occasion, action definitely speaks louder than words. Simply talking about what could or should be done doesn't get things done. The SNP and Labour administration have neglected the Economic Development and Planning Department, now resulting in delays in planning and building control. These are significant and a real risk to getting developments off the ground. While we know there is a shortage of qualified planners across Scotland, the shortage is being amplified in rural local authorities. We need to see action to get these posts filled in Dumfries and Galloway and across the rural areas to have a viable planning system that supports the redevelopment of derelict buildings and vacant land, rather than slowing it or stopping their reuse. Hopefully, this will allow them to become more engaged, and in particular identifying these sites that may be suitable for greening, growing, planting, or even biological diversity opportunities. The Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee passed, and indeed the Parliament passed, new land reform measures to help communities intervene and prevent derelict buildings hampering economic sustainability. And these powers are simply not being used or promoted to the extent they could. We must prioritise development in brownfield sites and previously used land, especially for things like new housing developments across all sectors. Although I would like to see a lot more done to build housing in the low-cost social housing section. In our manifesto, the Scottish Conservatives called for the introduction of compulsory sale orders for long-term unoccupied properties. In many cases, unoccupied and dilapidated, and they're becoming a blight on our communities, which is why we believe this remains the best course of action. Similarly, the Scottish Conservatives proposed relaxing planning laws to allow for the redevelopment of unoccupied businesses within our town centres into affordable housing. Not only would this increase footfall, but turn them into places where people go. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, having a strategy is totally worthless provided unless it's provided with commitment, resources and funding to take seriously the growing problem before it gets totally out of hand.
Thank you, Mr Carson. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Jackie Dunbar for around 4 minutes, Mr Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Emma Harper for tabling her motion on an issue that is of deep concern to all our communities. The Parliament's Economy Committee has just completed our inquiry into town centres, and the challenge of vacant and derelict buildings and land was a common thread that ran throughout the evidence we heard from across the country, reflecting the fact that the problem is increasing, and it's not just a historic legacy of our declining industrial base, but also the more recent decline in our town centres. I'm pleased the committee agreed to visit my hometown of Dumfries during that inquiry, seeing for themselves buildings mentioned in Emma Harper's motion. And ironically, on the day they did visit, a major arterial route through the town, English Street, had just been closed off because a derelict, long empty, long neglected building had been deemed unsafe. That building was a stark example of the fact that landlords and developers are not queuing up to invest in town centre properties as the near free-for-all in out-town developments over the years, coupled with the... I'll take an intervention at that point. Yeah, yeah.
Emma Harper.
Thank Colin Smith for taking an intervention. The building that you measured on, that you mentioned on Treasure Cove on English Street, that was the only response that I received from the owner, and from that we were able to then support and engage with the local authorities so that a demolition could proceed with that building. So that's something that I think it has been an interesting challenge to have the engagement from the owner of that site, but something has been done now.
Colin Smith, and give you the time back.
Thank you very much, President Officer. I think one of the challenges of that building, though, is, first of all, it was actually incredibly challenging for the council to track the owner down. Secondly, with all respect to the owner, there has been years of neglect on that building from an owner who has been absent. So all we've achieved so far is to demolish the building, but there's still no sign, sadly, of that building being developed into anything in the near future. And I think it does highlight the point I was making about that developers, owners are not queuing up to actually invest in our town centres. We've seen the rise in out-of-town developments over the years. We've seen the tide of online shopping become a tsunami during COVID, and that really has taken its toll on the high street that makes properties like that not viable in terms of new developments. There's too many of them and too many empty shops across towns like the Dumfries. But I think it also, that example, I think exposed the challenges that local council face in taking action against those often absent landlords who allow the properties to fall into such a state of disrepair. I don't think the powers they have go far enough. Craig Ellis from South Ayrshire Council Planning Department and Emma Harper's region told the Economy Committee during an inquiry the expectation of the powers is greater than what the powers actually are. If a council wants to undertake work on a building, it needs to show it has a plan for that building, that it's in the public interest and they can afford it. Whether it's issuing an amenity notice, a defective building notice, a dangerous building notice or compulsory purchase of a property, councils at present often simply don't have the resources either needed to take that action. Finlay Carson raised the issue of planning. Research by the Royal Town Planning Institute for Scotland showed that in June 2021, right across Scotland, budgets for planning services had been reduced by 42% since 2009, and nearly a third of planning staff had been cut. So often there isn't the staff to pursue landlords, especially given the fact that often it ends in the council having to fund repairs on a property at a stage when it has fallen into a state of disrepair, then try to claim that money back from the owners, which is incredibly challenging, and on occasions results in the council ending up owning the property. And that's a concern, I have to say, with Emma Harper's motion and the former Interfloor factory. There's a little chance, in my view, of the council being successful in claiming back any money they spend on that building from the current owner, certainly at the level of investment that would be needed to make a difference. And therefore, the council could end up owning that particular factory. Now, funding a future purpose for a site that will have had 110 years of industrial pollution is way beyond the resources of a local authority. The scale of the challenge on sites like this means we need a strategic national approach with government intervention through agencies such as Scottish Enterprise and South of Scotland Enterprise to invest in clearing sites and making them suitable for future use. Now, that does occur at a local level on occasion. And Finlay Carson mentioned the George Hotel. I can tell him the council bought that hotel. They bought it within a few months of taking over the current administration after years of the Conservatives doing absolutely nothing, including Mr Carson, who was a councillor at the time. So the council did take action in buying the George Hotel, but the cost of that modest building and turning it into something that's suitable is enormous, never mind what the cost would be for a site the size of the former Interfloor factory in Dumfries. So councils need support to make sure they can actually invest in projects, but when the project is the scale of that factory, I think we do need major government intervention to clear those sites and make them fit for purpose. But concluding, President Officer, on a positive note, on their visit to Dumfries, the Economy Committee did meet with the Mid-Steeple Quarter, a new community benefit company, and I'll declare an interest as a local resident who's a member of that cooperative. The Mid-Steeple Quarter are taking on the neglect of those absent landlords by taking back their high street shop by shop, investing in those properties to deliver that mix of use our towns need, not just quality retail space that is suitable and affordable for businesses, but community space and, crucially, new housing, so we once again have people living in our towns. But to support them and others, I think the government does need to recognise that the cost of turning derelict town centre properties into, for example, housing
you
will always
be
more
Mr.
expensive
Smith.
Than greenfield sites, and therefore they need that support in order to make that happen and really start to tackle the blight of derelict properties on our high streets.
Thank you very much. I now call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Ariane Burgess for around 4 minutes. Ms. Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating my colleague and friend, Emma Harper, on securing this vital debate tonight on a subject which I'm sure everybody in the Chamber and indeed everyone across the country can relate to. Derelict sites blight our communities. They impact on public health and they're not representative of the modern post-industrial Scotland that we're abiding in today. Presiding Officer, the potential for reusing vacant and derelict sites, also known as empty brownfield to some, is huge. It's difficult to think of a single major area of Scottish public policy that would not benefit from a concerted national effort to bring these sites back into use. Focusing on these sites as a vehicle for delivery could help to enhance policy coordination across Civic Scotland by concentrating effort and resources where they are most needed, a tangible example of the place principle in action. Transforming Scotland's legacy sites requires innovation and technical skills across a variety of professional disciplines, from ecologists, demolition teams and architects, through to space planners, construction experts and renewable heat engineers. With the right strategic leadership, we could use this opportunity to develop the skills and commercial expertise Scotland needs to shift to a sustainable growth path and deliver a green recovery. By focusing on vacant and derelict land, we can do this in a way that will help direct resources and support to the parts of the country that need it most, making sure that those left behind by the last chapter in Scotland's economic history are at the forefront of the next. Presiding Officer, of course, as a member of the Parliament's NZEC Committee, I'm interested in climate action. And as we know, climate action needs to be a collective endeavour. But barely half of those living in our most deprived communities, those with the highest concentrations of vacant and derelict land, see it as an urgent priority. If we really want to make a climate action a collective priority, then tackling our legacy of vacant and derelict sites is key in getting the climate message through to everyone. Yes, of course.
Can
I get my time back?
You can get the time back, Mr. Dunbar.
I appreciate you taking intervention. Could you set out where the Scottish Government have got it wrong over the last 15 years when you're only suggesting they do something now, and in light of the legislation that was passed in the last Parliament?
Can remarks be made through the chair, please?
Thank you very much. I've not been here for 15 years. I've been a former councillor, and I have been trying to get the derelict sites sorted out. But I'm sure the minister will be able to speak on his term that he's been here in this parliament. When you think and when you pause and think about it, many of Scotland's derelict sites are part. I'm naked. Yes,
Minister.
Of course.
I wonder if the member would agree with me that one of the challenges we face in Scotland over vacant and derelict land is the deindustrialisation which was inflicted upon Scotland in the 1980s.
Minister, could you please address your comments to the microphone?
By a government we didn't elect.
Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. Will I sit down again?
Jackie Dunbar.
Go for it, Jackie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for that intervention. Yeah, I would agree that there is a lot that needs to be done and a lot that we could actually do that has been foisted upon us since the 1980s and further on from that. But this is not a debate on independence, Presiding Officer.
It should be.
Presiding Officer, like many across the chamber, my Aberdeen Donside constituency also falls victim to derelict sites, one of which I've been trying to see action on for many years, including as a former ward councillor. The Logie Shops on Manor Drive, near the Hadigan roundabout and just off the newly named Brian Adam Road, has lain empty for well over 20 years and, quite frankly, is an eyesore. I've raised the site, which is in derelict condition, with Aberdeen City Council, and I'm pleased that they've agreed to carry out a renewed safety assessment of the site, and I await the outcome. And before anybody stands up, I have contacted Aberdeen City Council before there was an SNP administration and after. I'm taking no prisoners when it comes to who is in administration there. However, I will be urging the local authority to use the powers outlined by Emma Harper, MSP, to see decisive action taken on the building once and for all. The public sector, including Aberdeen City Council, can lead the way in identifying the potential of these sites to be transformed into assets that provide real benefit to local communities. How great it would be to see something like a community orchard in that place. It's small, it would have a huge benefit. But this could include much needed green space for health and well-being, growing spaces, community facilities, and housing and business use. I therefore ask the Minister for a commitment that the Scottish Government will work with local authorities, as they already do, but continue to do that as much as possible, and will provide as much support as they can to see derelict sites and communities across the country addressed. In conclusion, I again congratulate my colleague Emma Harper on bringing this debate forward. Addressing derelict sites, including across Aberdeen Donside, brings numerous benefits, and we must see national action taken to bring about meaningful change.
Thank you very much, Ms Dunbar. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Audrey Nicholl for around 4 minutes, Ms Burgess.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to debate this issue, which is a particular challenge in rural communities where a vacant or derelict site can be a long-term eyesore in the heart of the community. And I thank my colleague Emma Harper for securing the debate. As the motion rightly notes, in many cases, these sites reflect decades of decline in our communities and symbolise the loss of industry and essential infrastructure. Across the region I represent, the Highlands and Islands, there are 188 registered vacant and derelict sites. They include disused railways in a region crying out for improved public transport, abandoned auction marts and agricultural buildings at a time when land prices make it challenging for new entrants to the agricultural industry, and even family homes at a time when home ownership is increasingly unaffordable. By failing to enable the redevelopment of these sites, and many of them are developable, we are not only wasting the embodied energy in these buildings, but squandering an opportunity to improve our communities. These sites offer tremendous potential if brought back into use by communities to respond to their changing needs. For example, in Derelict, the community responded by, supported by the Community Housing Trust, has transformed a derelict site in the centre of the village into 25 homes with a range of tenures and a community hub, which is Scotland's first public passive house building. The award-winning mixed development represents a great model of what's possible for communities across Scotland with the right support and funding and a partnership approach. In Applecross, residents purchased a vacant site from the NHS Highland using the community asset transfer process and funding from a range of sources. Now, with the help of Community Housing Trust, instead of a vacant site, the community has three accessible homes next door to the GP surgery. Presiding officer, from April next year, the devolution of powers over non-domestic rates and empty property relief to local authorities could enable local councils to disincentivise absentee landlords who far too often neglect the maintenance and security of vacant sites and vacant and derelict sites, as we have heard already. Public bodies need land assembly powers, such as compulsory purchase and compulsory sales orders, which are effective, efficient and fair in order to support delivery of much-needed regeneration infrastructure and the reuse of vacant land and property. Currently, implementation of these powers is patchy, with councils being understandably cautious about taking on ownership of sites that are often in very poor condition. Presiding officer, councils should be encouraged by the numerous successful projects across Scotland that have seen vacant and derelict sites taken on and redeveloped by communities. There is a real opportunity for local and national government to build partnerships with charities, cooperatives and membership organisations who often have an inspiring vision for new neighbourhoods they want to shape. It's also important to note that many councils are willing to exercise purchase powers but don't have community groups with the capacity and confidence to undertake what are significant specialist long-term projects. That's why the Scottish Greens have been making the case for more long-term support for revenue costs for community organisations and highlighting the importance of key enablers in the sector, including the Scottish Land Fund and Community Housing Trust. And that is why the Bute House Agreement commits the Scottish Government to doubling the Scottish Land Fund by the end of this parliamentary session to prioritise bringing vacant and derelict land and property back into productive use with rural repopulation as a vital objective.
Thank you very much, Ms Burgess. Due to the number of members who wish to still participate in the debate, including a few who have been moved to press their buttons since the debate started, I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate for up to 30 minutes, and I invite Emma Harper to move that motion without notice.
Thank you. Yeah, moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. And with that, I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Paul Sweeney for around 4 minutes. Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I very much thank Emma Harper for bringing this debate forward this afternoon. And I've really enjoyed listening to your very eloquent setting of the scene in your opening speech. It was a great contribution around the sort of challenges and opportunities that derelict and vacant land bring to communities. So for my very short contribution today, I want to highlight a scenario in my own constituency that on the face of it seems like a golden opportunity to transform a derelict site for community benefit, but looking under the surface, it's more challenging. Presiding Officer, as the daughter of a greengrocer, I am utterly loyal to community wealth-building approaches, and like many colleagues, I'm lucky enough to have independent shops, coffee shops, makers, designers, artisan bakeries, you name it. Lots of different invested members of the community bringing character and life to local spaces. And what we define as vacant and derelict land can equally make a contribution to that character and life. The Scottish Government and COSLA place principle sits at the heart of addressing the needs and realising the full potential of communities. Places are shaped by the way resources, services and assets are directed and used by the people who live in and invest in them. And Aberdeen City, much like the rest of the UK, has a legacy of land contamination resulting from past industrial use, including the historical oil and gas sector. Having said that, the same energy sector is considered by some to have actually avoided a bigger cohort of derelict and vacant land emerging in the northeast over the years. But in these circumstances, local authorities are required to remove unacceptable risks to people and the environment and to seek to bring damaged land back into beneficial use. And it's on this point I want to talk about a scenario in my constituency. So I've been working with constituents living adjacent to an area of land owned by the local authority, but leased over many years as an industrial site. The oil and gas downturn saw the site vacated and flattened, but the lease remains in place and the site is now contaminated. In recent years, the site has emerged as a natural habitat, hosting a range of animals and bird life. Local residents derive real pleasure from the site. There is a feeling of attachment and well-being connected to the space. And bizarrely, the leaseholder's annual maintenance of the site, which is to be applauded, can actually remove some of the habitat that is emerging and attracting wildlife into it. However, efforts to date to explore how the status of the site can shift from contaminated land to community asset have proved very difficult and perhaps demonstrate a lack of synergy between the aspirations of community wealth building set against the legislative and policy framework around vacant and derelict land. Now, I welcome the Scottish Land Commission's report on transforming Scotland's approach to vacant and derelict land, and I note the recommendation around aligning policy to support delivery, and that action should be taken to make it easier to overcome ownership barriers to land reuse. And I completely agree with this recommendation. However, in the case I've outlined, the issue is made more complex by the leased status of the land, and I anticipate the understandable hesitation around that status changing. So, realistically, this is a really difficult situation for community members to grapple with. So I'd be interested in the Minister's thoughts around this particular scenario, and of course I would be very pleased to engage further down the line on this type of situation. So to conclude, I'm very grateful to Emma Harper for bringing this motion forward, and I look forward to working further on this issue in my own constituency in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Willie Coffey, around 4 minutes, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to Emma Harper for bringing this motion for debate in the Chamber. It's an issue that I have a strong personal passion for as a trustee of the Glasgow City Heritage Trust. And indeed, Glasgow has been long synonymous with its architectural beauty and the grandeur of its buildings, which make it one of the most handsome urban cityscapes in the world. And indeed, that is a testament to previous generations of enlightened Glaswegians that we remain blessed by the legacy of the geniuses of Alexander Greek Thompson, James Miller, John James Burnett and Charles Rennie Mackintosh. And they were able to flourish in a city like Glasgow due to a potent combination of inspired patrons, including the City Corporation, who understood the enduring value of good design and also design rules that were devised by the first city architects, as John Carrick, and ensured that Glasgow followed a rigorous plan driven by the City Improvement Trust that gave rise to a dense grid of tenement-lined streets that are so fundamental to our city's identity. And whilst we admire and adore the product of this architectural golden age, and we need to do everything we can to preserve and protect it today, it's a truth that current planning law would not enable that to be built today. It actually prevents it happening. And that is one of the great ironies of the things we cherish, the communities we like the most in our city, are actually unable to be replicated because of current planning law. And that's something that is a great disappointment that we haven't been able to address in NPF4. And indeed, of course, the work of organisations like Glasgow City Heritage Trust is pivotal, established 15 years ago in 2007. Happy to take an intervention, yes.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Paul Sweeney, for taking the intervention. I fed into the National Planning Framework's draft strategy, specifically focusing on tackling vacant, abandoned, derelict land and buildings. Would you agree that we do need to continue to look at these issues to make sure that the powers are created in order to tackle what we see are a problem eyesore sites?
Paul Sweeney.
I absolutely agree with the member, and a major part of it is that previous generations had plot-based development rules for planning, so they actually laid out a city plan and built the city up progressively, and private investment was invited to build it up in that sequence as planned by the city architect in this instance, or the City Improvement Trust. And indeed, many of those developments were sponsored by the city itself. Today, our planning system is fundamentally discretionary. All of the basis on which buildings are designed and developed are left in the hands of developers. And there's no code of design, no code of how a building should look in relation to the community. There's no code around the materials that should be used. It's very arbitrary, and often they're value engineered to the point of not being very well designed at all. And that is a major concern. There are also perverse incentives at the heart of our planning system that drive perverse behaviours. So, for example, in Glasgow, we have over 1,800 buildings are listed in the city, and of those, currently 108 are on the Buildings at Risk Register for Scotland. Which is quite a high rate, but a major impediment to bringing those buildings at risk that are of architectural and heritage value back into use is the fact that to do so incurs a rate of 20% VAT, but to knock it down and build from scratch incurs 0% VAT. So there's actually a perverse incentive, and it's what's known as a conservation deficit, that often militates against bringing potentially fantastic buildings back into use, as described by members this evening. I could rhyme off a whole list of ones in Glasgow, not the least the Springburn Winter Gardens in Springburn Park, which I've been desperately trying to bring back into active use for over 10 years, and continue to be frustrated in that goal. But one of the major impediments is that VAT issue. Also, this conservation deficit, because the most ways to deal with that is to apply for funding like the Heritage, National Lottery Heritage Fund, or to the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund, or to the UK Government Levelling Up Fund, as Glasgow is currently doing for the People's Palace. But fundamentally, the problem with those is that it's a lottery, and it's always going to be losers in that process. I don't understand why this government can't think more laterally about this and say, these buildings have long-term value. How do we measure the value of these restored assets? How do we actually look at the fact that we need to guarantee these buildings as an incredible, irreplaceable and precious part of our built heritage, and recognise that simply throwing grants at it on a sort of arbitrary lottery-type basis isn't really going to work and isn't going to be sustainable in the long term? Because if you take the City Heritage Trust, its annual budget barely touches the sides of the scale of the problem needed in Glasgow. 70,000 tenements in the city needing £3 billion worth of repairs. I mean, at the rate at which the City Heritage Trust is funded, it would take 2,000 years to do it. You know, so we need to seriously up our game in Scotland about how we resource this. And I think a national plan that isn't just about throwing money after projects that won't work or be viable. It's about actually providing that initial investment to then, over maybe 100 years, earn it back. It will be council tax revenues, it will be non-domestic rates, it will be rents that will come back into the city or the urban community. It will raise the value of property in the area and reinvigorate communities that are otherwise suffering terribly, because actually a higher proportion of these buildings at risk are in the poorest districts of our towns and cities. So in this regard, I think it's important the government considers ways that simply don't extend to grant funding of how we deal with the conservation deficit problem in Scotland, because it's a major issue that holds up the potential rejuvenation of thousands of amazing architectural edifices in our cities and towns. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Sweeney. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Around 4 minutes, Mr Coffey.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you also to my colleague, Emma Harper, for bringing this matter to the attention of the Parliament. It's high time this problem was aired and solved, as it's been a long-standing and difficult problem to tackle. It's actually come at a good time, since I've also been trying to do some work in this in recent months and years in my constituency of Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley. My own focus is mostly on empty or abandoned shops, but there are a number of pieces of land that are no better than waste ground. And sadly, there are some sites too that are in current use, but have little or no maintenance to keep them in good order either. We all have particular buildings, usually empty shops, in our cities, towns and villages, Presiding Officer, that aren't exactly contributing positively to the look and feel of our towns. Some of them are in fact middens, a good Scots word, and I use that word deliberately because that's what they are, and their owners should be ashamed of themselves, but sadly they aren't, and that's one of the key problems I think we have here. As Emma Harper says, they are often owned by individuals or corporations who don't give a jot about our towns and may never even have visited them, uncontactable and hiding behind agents who allegedly manage the properties for them. Some are in local ownership, and it's very difficult to even get hold of them to ask them to take some action, even to clean them up. I recently went on a walk through my own town of Kilmarnock with two council officials to whom I was very grateful, and we saw many of these examples for ourselves. What became clear was how very little of it fell under the jurisdiction of the local authority. They do have power to act, and members have referenced these powers over dangerous buildings and so on, but powers in relation to amenity or dirty, filthy buildings are limited and usually end up costing the public purse when it's the owner's responsibility to act. So where does the answer really lie? I'm not convinced, and neither are my council colleagues, that it lies in granting more powers, amenity or otherwise, to the planning authorities. This always seems to end up in legal disputes, especially when we're talking about subjective matters that deal with attractiveness or ugliness. Who would define what this actually means? And the owners ultimately usually have no funds or resources available to take any of those actions to remedy the situation. Now, our recent work on developing our national planning framework is going to be a really powerful tool for local communities in taking forward plans to revitalise our towns, to create those community spaces and so on, as we have done successfully in Kilmarnock already. But I don't think this problem can be solved by NPF4, and these awful sites will remain to let us all down. Perhaps we need some sort of new thinking. Would some kind of clean-up fund or town centre community bond fund work that asks local traders and those absentees, if we can ever track them down, to put a small amount of money aside in a voluntary fund or otherwise, and perhaps some public money too, if that was possible, and encourage public donations too. I think that a solution might lie in there, presiding officer, to promote a voluntary town centre clean-up fund where everybody can make a contribution. After all, presiding officer, our towns, cities and villages actually belong to the people who live in them all of their lives, and it's in everyone's interests, people, traders, absent owners too, and probably the local authority, to work together to be part of the solution to this particular problem. Surely all of the buildings and parcels of land should have a positive purpose and make a real contribution to the vitality of our towns. Have I time to take, Mr Sweeney?
Briefly.
I'm just coming to the end anyway, but pleased to hear what you have to say.
I thank the member for his debate, speech so far in the debate. I think it's been a really interesting speech. Would he recognise that perhaps a solution to the problem he describes might be a heritage levy on new development in areas like conservation areas, which would help contribute to the common good? Also, potentially, the solution identified by the Built Environment Forum of Scotland around having common sinking funds for both residential but even potentially commercial property, so that common repairs are well funded in advance and it isn't simply a reactive thing where suddenly a massive amount of money has to be spent very suddenly in reaction to a failure of a building or a structure?
I think they're all potentially good ideas, and some of those themes we talked about with council officials, just to gauge what their reaction to something like that might be, about getting some kind of advanced funding pots put away, set aside for these kinds of purposes might work. So hopefully some fruition might come to that. Just as I was winding up, presiding officer, I think all our buildings and parcels of land need to have a positive purpose and make a real contribution to the vitality of all our towns. And I hope, presiding officer, that this has given the minister and hopefully some of the members some food for thought too. I thank once again Emma Harper again for bringing the issue to our attention, and sincerely hope we can make some real progress on it in the coming years. Our cities, towns and villages deserve nothing less. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Coffey. And I call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Bob Dorris, around 4 minutes, Mr Kerr.
I doubt, presiding officer, listening to many speeches from the SNP benches, you'd hardly imagine they'd been in power for 15 years. These are not problems that have arrived in the last few weeks or months. These are problems that we've been dealing with and living with in Scotland for a long time. So after 15 years in power, I think Emma Harper has actually highlighted the inadequacies of our own government, because she highlights also the powers that local authorities have got and don't have, and therefore there is a role here for the Scottish Government. I think think Paul Sweeney gave a marvellous speech, actually, in highlighting the need for the government to be more imaginative and more flexible in how they deal with these things. Can I also say to Jackie Nobar, I'm actually delighted to hear there's a Brian Adam Road. Absolutely delighted to hear that. And I was astonished, but not entirely surprised, must be honest, to hear the Minister say that the person to blame for all of the problems that we're talking about in this debate is Mrs Thatcher. My goodness me, how predictable and how lame was that? We live in one of the most beautiful countries in the world. In fact, we regularly in Scotland are acclaimed as the most beautiful country in the world. And our landscape is something that makes all of us feel proud. Something inside of us warms up when we see the beautiful scenes that our country is renowned for around the world. As parliamentarians, I believe that we've been appointed by our fellow Scots to be guardians of Scotland's natural beauty. And just as previous generations have preserved our nation's landscape so that we could enjoy it, we also have a responsibility to conserve the beauty of our built environment so future generations can enjoy it as well. But let's not be kidding ourselves. When we talk about the beauty of Scotland, let's not be kidding ourselves. Every fibre of Scotland is not beautiful. I wish I could say it was. And as been mentioned in the speeches that have already been delivered, there are many parts of our country where land is not only unused, but it's an eyesore. And failure to address the problem is nothing short of a levelling down approach. There is such a thing as entropy. It's real. And the kind of neglect from public bodies, agencies and councils, as well as owners, comes from an uncaring attitude that says to people that their environment, their lives, their well-being is less important than others. And the way that many places in central Scotland have been neglected is Scotland's shame, where policy makers who live in nice, pleasant suburban areas are happy to leave their fellow Scots in the worst kind of squalor. So rather than accepting the status quo, the Scottish Government should be embracing a true levelling up agenda, empowering people, empowering authorities, building buildings that are the complement to our country's natural beauty. And as already known, we don't have enough houses in Scotland. And for far too long, we've not been building enough homes. Councils and governments take too long selling off unused land. There's a whole register of land that is in the public sector that could be usefully utilised to build more homes. And having been declared surplus of requirements by councils, buildings, as we've heard already in this debate, take far too long to sell. We have not been imaginative enough, for example, to adapt buildings on our high streets to accommodate housing. Why do we just keep talking about this without doing something about it?
Colin Smith.
Would the member take an intervention at that point? Does Mr Kerr not accept, though, that the point he's making is very valid, but one of the disincentives when it comes to investing in regenerating a building in a town centre, say for housing, is the fact that the level of VAT that's levied on existing buildings is actually higher than the VAT level on a new build on out of towns. That's a perverse disincentive to actually tackle the problem of housing. Maybe he can have a word with his party and to see if we can address that and actually reduce the level of VAT on regenerating existing buildings to the same level as on new builds.
Stephen Kerr.
Look, and I'm happy to address any of the perverse illogicalities that exist around the need for us to take action on the areas that I'm highlighting and other members have highlighted in this debate. Because what we are seeing here, if I may coin a phrase, is a collection that one might call the anti-growth coalition, the people that are stopping these things from happening. And we cannot just champion more housing, by the way. We must build housing, and I think Paul Sweeney touched on this, but we must build more housing that promotes community rather than living inside our own bubble, which is happening too often in what we used to have as communities in a country that was proud of its sense of community and should be proud of its sense of community. We must champion energy-efficient housing so these buildings serve us for generations to come, and we must champion the right type of housing. We must champion beautiful houses that people want to live in beautiful neighbourhoods. Beauty should be at the heart of public discourse. It should be part of our conversation about housing and development and spaces. As the great philosopher Roger Scruton put it, we are losing beauty and there is a danger that with it we will lose the meaning of life. And I close with the words of a friend of mine, Sir John Hayes, not of this parish, but of the House of Commons, someone whose ideas are driven by an inordinate sense of common sense. He said, "Sadly, we live in an age that is dull and utilitarian, in which mystery and magic are extraordinarily unfashionable. It is odd that that should be, for it was not true for most of our history and has not been so for most great civilizations. It is unusual to be as utilitarian as we are, but now it is time for a change, for a renaissance. It is time for beauty to be put back at the heart of government policy. And Sir John Hayes is right, and we can start by tackling the dereliction that we see all too much of around us.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. We've extended the debate by half an hour, but we're at risk of going beyond that if we're not careful. I call Bob Doris for up to 4 minutes, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Emma Harper for bringing this debate forward to allow us to talk about issues with vacant and derelict land in our communities and neglected and abandoned buildings as well, which come quite strongly within the debate. There are blights in our communities, and I was motivated to make this unscheduled contribution because of my experience as the constituent MSP for Maryhill and Springburn. I want to start off by talking about when MSPs go and talk to local authorities about buildings being unsafe. In my case, I could pick several examples, but I'll talk about the Maryhill Tavern and the Redan building on Maryhill Road, unsafe and eyesores, and the Talisman, now thankfully demolished in Springburn, again an eyesore. When you go to local authorities, they look to see if it is structurally safe, i.e. will it fall down? Will bits continue to fall off the building? Not whether it is accessible to kids and reasonable mitigation put in place to stop kids getting in there, or that it is a blight in the urban landscape of our communities. So maybe we have to look a little bit again what we deem to be safe and acceptable for communities. I think that's something I wanted to put on the record. But I want to say a little bit about compulsory purchase orders also. It's clearly easier to secure those if there's a strategic plan for the use of the land or for the building that the land sits on, preferably a community-led strategic plan, as happened in relation to the Talisman, which is now demolished. Now, I'll declare an interest because that community plan was in part formed by the Springburn Regeneration Forum, which I was co-founder of, and the Spirit of Springburn, which I am a trustee of, but I take no credit for that achievement, because I facilitated others in the community to get a charrette in the community to deliver recommendations to say that the Talisman eyesore, that derelict pub must go. And the local authority moved for a compulsory purchase order, and the owner suddenly thought, I'll get this site demolished myself rather than face the threat of a compulsory purchase order. So there's a positive impact. Only if I can get the time back, Mr Sweeney. I'm sorry.
Very briefly, Mr Sweeney.
I thank the member for his contribution, but they also recognise that in the case of 10 years ago since the demolition of Springburn Public Halls, one of the major concerns in the city is also the buildings in council ownership that remain derelict and blighting the area, including Springburn.
Yeah. Bob Doris.
Absolutely happy to acknowledge that, and that's something that transcends all political persuasions in local government across a long period of time, I think, Mr Sweeney. I'd like to talk about compulsory purchase orders in relation to the Maryhill Tavern and the Redan buildings on Maryhill Road. They are now going to happen to allow us to connect with regeneration work in Comun Street, in Barrisdale Street and in Lindale Street, which have been lying empty on wasteland for far too long, as part of a long-term transformational regeneration area approach. So lots of good things happening, but it takes time, planned and careful consideration and massive investment by Glasgow City Council, by the Scottish Government, and we're hearing some levering up funds may go to contribute towards that as well. So things do happen. I'd also like to mention where things have happened. In Royston, there's a new community hub, which includes a wonderful new community centre and food pantry with money from the Scottish Land Fund, from Glasgow City Council and from the Scottish Government's Capital Regeneration Fund, and a previous derelict triangle site in Royston, where we got significant amounts of money again from the Land Fund and from the Scottish Government to have a park on the hill, previously blights and eyesores. I'd also like to say, Presiding Officer, that we have to look at this in connection with how we use green space. Declare another interest, Presiding Officer, because next to me at Black Hill Road, there was a massive development on green space, and I stay next by, so I've got a direct interest, Presiding Officer, for up to 1,000 properties to be built there. If you offer private developers an opportunity to build 1,000 properties on green space, guess what? They're not going to invest in the brownfield vacant and derelict land sites. I am glad we put an end to that potential development. Finally, Presiding Officer, I think this has been an incredibly constructive debate, although I do think Mr Kerr and Mr Carson let themselves down a bit
because this was never tribal, this was never party political. This coming together as a parliament to do what we can to improve the community that we all serve. I think those two members of this parliament let themselves down a bit in this afternoon's debate.
Thank you, Mr. Doris. I now call on Tom Arthur to respond to the debate. Minister, for 7 minutes or so. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I register the tone of your voice in underscoring 7 minutes. And 7 minutes is certainly far too short to do justice in responding to what I think has been an excellent debate with a range of interesting contributions from all members. And I very much value and I give you undertaking I will reflect carefully on the comments that have been made and engage with my officials and other stakeholders on these points. Let me begin, though, by thanking Emma Harper for bringing this debate to Parliament and affording us this opportunity, and also recognising the work of the Vacant and Derelict Land Task Force, which is playing an important role, I think not just in informing this debate that we've had, but indeed in informing the work that the government's taking forward. I think just to outline at the outset, there's a broad range of work that the Scottish Government is undertaking. We have recently published a revised draft of the National Planning Framework 4, which seeks to really get us back very fundamentally to a plan-led system, particularly around housing. But I would note policies on Greenbelt and on brownfield, vacant and derelict land and empty buildings, which I think align with much of what members have spoken about. As well as what we're doing around planning policy, we are also working to ensure that we have a planning system that is properly resourced. This is a challenge, as we all recognise, not just in terms of fiscal resource, but ensuring we have a sufficient number of planners. I would add that the challenge around recruitment of planners is not unique to Scotland, but with regards to the action that we are taking here, we're working very closely with the high-level group, so with partners such as RTPI, Heads of Planning Scotland, the Improvement Service. We've published the Future Planner Project, and we're working to implement that. I'm also having constructive engagement with the private sector as well, so we can do more work to promote people into planning, because planning as a profession, I would want to reiterate, as I said in front of the committee earlier this month, is a wonderful profession to go into for any young person and affords people an opportunity to play a really key role in shaping their places. But it's not just policy, we're backing it up with funding as well. We have the Place-Based Investment Programme, which includes the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund, which goes back to 2013. But with PBIB over the course of this Parliament, that's £325 million of capital investment, which is making a difference. We also launched this in this parliamentary session, the Vacant and Derelict Land Improvement Programme. That is £50 million over the course of this parliament. I was delighted to be at Clyde Gateway a few weeks back to attend the official opening of the first project completed following funding through the Vacant and Derelict Land Improvement Programme. And that is an important resource because we do recognise, given our industrial heritage, there can be significant challenges around decontamination and remediation of land. And that can play an important part in de-risking and leveraging investment from the other sectors, certainly.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank the Minister for giving way. Does he recognise that Clyde Gate was an interesting model, unique in Scotland as the only public development corporation left in the country, and perhaps it is a model that could be emulated at a grander scale for Glasgow as a whole, perhaps a national level as well, to bring these distressed assets back into use?
Minister.
I recognise very much what the member said. I have been incredibly impressed with what I've seen at Clyde Gateway, and particularly what I could describe as a bold and almost entrepreneurial spirit in terms of their vision for the area. And I think there is certainly something in Mr. Sweeney's remarks about how that model can potentially play a bigger role, if not being replicated in at least the culture and vision and attitude informing more of how the public sector as a whole engages in projects of long-term redevelopment. Emma Harper did ask how we can use current legislation to effectively deal with VDL, and a number of members raised the issue of compulsory purchase orders and indeed the possibility of compulsory sales orders. Through our delivery programme with regards to NPF4, it is a commitment that we are going to look at how we can update legislation on CPO, and within that programme of work, look at the introduction of CSO. As members will appreciate, this is an extremely complex area. It requires careful consideration, but it is something I recognise there's a keen interest in, and indeed where we do have existing CPO provisions, I recognise that there is criticism that they are somewhat dated, challenging to use, and as such it warrants careful consideration around how we can update these powers to ensure all of our local authorities and are equipped with the legislative tools required to affect the outcomes that we want to see. There was a point Mr Carson touched on, I think it was with regards to permitted development rights for residential conversions. We have recently concluded a consultation on permitted development rights, which covers a range of areas, including use class orders responding to some of the recommendations from the Town Centre Review. We will be publishing the outcome of that consultation and our decisions, rather, and what legislative action we're going to take shortly. But I would stress on the issue of permitted development rights for residential, that is not something I am minded to pursue, simply because I think, given the significance of housing and its importance, it is something that still has to exist within the planning system. A number of members raised Mid-Steeple Quarter. I was delighted to visit Mid-Steeple earlier in the year. I'm delighted also that the Scottish Government has been able to support that through the Place-Based Investment Programme and indeed the Empowering Communities Programme. It is a great example of a community taking ownership and driving forward change, as Mr Smith said, shop by shop to take back their high street. And that fundamentally touches on a broader point, which is that of community wealth building, which I think is fundamentally the destination. For me, it represents a maturation of our process of redevelopment and regeneration, building on the place principle. Because ultimately, all of these challenges that we face within our high streets and with vacant and derelict land are a reflection of the underlying economic model. And often that has been one of wealth extraction, where owners of premises are not situated within their localities and as such don't have a stake. So one of the key pillars of community wealth building is land and property. And I personally want to see more and more people being able to take, in communities, take ownership of these assets, and that's a key ambition that we have. And we'll have an opportunity to consider this in further detail tomorrow in a government debate I will be leading on asset transfer requests. Audrey Nicol had raised a number of issues in her remarks, and I would like to say I'd be more than happy to meet to discuss the specific details that she raised. Paul Sweeney, I recognise his long-standing passion for this area. I think it was a fascinating and actually quite provocative speech. One of the tensions that I was wrestling with was in my own mind is the grandeur of Glasgow was of an era before we had a statutory planning system. It was in the era of more permissive regulation, maybe the 1909 Act, the 1929 Act, I think there was a 34 Act. Equally, I was reflecting on it. That was an age when we also saw some of the most terrible and appalling housing conditions, which was certainly a prompt for the development of the modern planning system in 1947, owing its origins to public health concerns. But I think he raises some interesting points around design, and looking at our existing design codes nationally is something we will be doing as part of the delivery programme for NPF4. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious that time is against me and the debate has already been extended, but can I just thank all members for their contributions again, and particularly thank Emma Harper for bringing this debate to the Chamber.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.